Welcome to Carbonite Ultra U. In this episode, we're going to set up an expression device to be controlled from our Carbonite. This is going to be pretty awesome because with expression, we also get to leverage our live assist pages, and we'll go through everything for setting up an expression device. We've gone and jumped into our dashboard soft panel. Now, this needs to still be done from a hard panel. I want to hook up my expression graphics system so I can control using rostock, the sequencer and event system. First thing we want to do is, of course, figure out what our expression IP address is. I happen to be on the same device. In Windows, I'm going to go ahead and in the search bar, I'm going to type in CMD. I'm going to go ahead and type in ipconfig, and I can see the IP address that my expression is running on. Now that I know its IP address, we want to set up the device. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to go into our system menu, click next, next, and click on the right knob so we can go into device config. Now, as you can see, I've got a couple of devices already set up, but I don't have an expression. So we're going to click on the add new, and we get to pick from available slots. So we'll go ahead and use slot 0, and we are going to pick our type. And as you can see, there is a ton of options. We want to go with rostock. We'll click next because there are multiple rostock choices. There is a generic type, and this we use so we can send messages out to other devices and kind of bring down the total list of messages as well as give the custom type-in message. There's Ultrix, where again we list the Ultrix specific commands, and then finally expression. Now we hit next again, and now we can pick the IP address. So the first knob does nothing. The second knob will move the field. So as we saw, my IP address is 10.0.1.20. Now that we have that, we're able to hit next, and we get to our option page. The first option is the port value. Now this number you have to make sure matches what you have in expression. Now by default, they use 7788. I also am running dashboard on this computer. And in dashboard, I can set up a global rostock listener. So with dashboard, it'll also default to 7788. So normally, I make sure in my dashboard to change it to 7789. The next option is the pre-roll. Now, depending on your workflow, you can choose to have it that when you take the graphics system, it will fire a command based on roll clip being enabled or not enabled. Now, some people want this feature, and this value is what you have to set up to define how many frames before it starts the first frame of video. Next is whether or not roll clip has any bearing on it at all. So if you don't want that feature of firing any commands, well, we're going to turn that off. And I normally run this with this off. I like building custom controls that trigger the events, not just auto running the sequencer because I cut the key on and off. If you are going to use that, you are able to pick the command. You can send the next command, which is the standard advancing of the sequencer, or you can send a GPI value, which allows you in expression to define the function. So think of this as wanting to trigger a custom function that lives inside of expression. Very cool. Those are your options. Again, first knob scrolls through the option. Third knob is going to scroll through the values. Now that you're done, click on a knob and confirm these changes. So that's step one. Now we can see that we've got on IP port 0, we've got our expression device set up. Next, we're going to go over to the configure menu. We're going to go into our input. We're going to click to the next page. And now we're going to start associating our devices. So here, I'm going to click on the knob. And the first knob is going to allow me to pick my device. Now I want to click next in case there are any other values. Like with video servers or cameras, this is where you're going to give it its channel or ID number. Of course, with XPression and rostock, we define the sequencer through the event system as to the frame buffer controls. So now that we've done that, we hit select and we confirm that XPression 1.0 uses it. And you'll notice you can scroll the knob so that you can read, because again, on that little screen on the panel, there's extra room. And I can see that it uses slot 0. Let's go on and let's find CG2, select that device, the same expression device, because again, they're both going to use that same device. So there you go. This is number one, assigned in slot 0. Additionally, now that we've assigned those, if we were to go back to the system menu, go into that device config, you'll also see that we can scroll that knob and you can see that that slot has these two devices currently assigned and associated with it. So again, just helping if you needed to go back and edit it. I take this switcher file and I go to a different Carbonite Ultra. I want to see that, oh, right, this is the slot number. Now I have to change the IP address that associates with the expression that this switcher is actually talking to, making life very easy to move those file sets between different switchers. We've got something extra. Now, one of the really neat things that we can do with XPression in version 10 or version 9 with a license or on a graphite was we can serve up the XPression sequencer UI into a dashboard API. So as a little bonus, what we want to do here is go ahead, jump into dashboard, add that device so that we can then leverage the new version 4 feature of Live Assist pages. Now that we're in dashboard, we have expression devices as another type. What we need to do to add our expression is go in dashboard, click on the plus key, and we'll see there is an expression device, new expression. So we're going to click on this, and it's going to prompt us for the IP address, and just like before, and we can go ahead and give it a name. The port is defaulted to 8020, so let's not touch that. We're going to hit finish, and now, but we get the sequencer. It's going to open up the sequencer for me. I can change between small icons so I get more to a page. It'll reload all those icons. I can click on a graphic. I can preview the graphic. I could change what's in the subject line. And of course, that all updates instantaneously. I can queue it. I can double click on it, take it on air. And I can even press the eject key to have it transition and run its out element. You can also go into the detail view, which is reminiscent of the sequencer. And so I can see all of the graphics that I've created, as well as I can create a take ID. So I can pick from any scene and I can send it to any of my groups. And I can create a new scene that I can then go and I can edit. You pretty much have the ability to do a lot of the functionality right here inside of dashboard. How this ties in with our switcher, now we come into our configuration tab. If we go in that system tab over to our live assist, I can give any of these four user pages that I can assign inside of my live assist menu. So the first one is expression. So now what we can do is we can pick the device. So we know that we want this graphite expression and we want the sequencer items. So I've gone and I've added that in. Now I go to my inputs page, I go to the physical page, I go to CG1, and this is where I get to pick from any of those four pages to associate with this device. When we head back over to our panel, and when we're in Live Assist, now when I take that key here, like key 4, and we go ahead and we select CG1, right? Now I see that I've got my live bug. I can go ahead and I could go into a small view, which obviously now in this reduced size, they're gonna just be text icons, but I can see a whole bunch of the pages. Or of course I can go into large icons, in which case I still get all of that. I still have the flexibility to adjust this. I can control each side of the screen. It's pretty cool. I can see my icon. I can also just double click, bring in that graphic, hit the eject, take out the graphic. And it's all associated. So just by selecting that key here, it automatically followed to our custom pages menu and to our expression device. That is just the beginning of how we set up to talk to an expression. There's two more things that we want to do, and that's look at setting up the expression side of things. So now we're going to go over to expression and we're going to make sure that we configure it to receive the commands from our Ultra, but also the opportunity to turn on roslin. Even though we've got a graphics engine, we can also do still only pushing into the media stores. So let's head over and check that out. So here I have my expression system running. Now, it is a graphite, but hey, I can use graphites as standalone expression. So first up, I have to make sure that I go into my hardware setup and make sure that I have my GPI and Tally boards configured. I've got my rostock board. This allows me to set up the incoming rostock commands. This is done by hitting the add button, just simply picking a rostock device, clicking OK, coming in, setting it to TCP/IP 7788. Now, outgoing is if you want to be able to send commands from expression, from say the scene director to the Carbonite Ultra. And so if you want to do that, you want to make sure that you come in here and you add the switcher IP address to send rostock commands back to it. The Carbonites are hard coded to 7788. I can see the sequencer, and now as I move things up and down using the knob, the sequencer moves and all is functioning. There's all kinds of things you can do with custom control macros and triggering specific events for things like wipes and sending all kinds of commands. And additionally, you also can send commands from expression back to the switchers. Without getting into too much of that, the other thing we wanted to look at really quick was setting up roslin connectors. So no matter how many other devices you have, you can always add roslin connectors, no matter how many channels of full motion graphics your expression has. When we set up a roslin connector, you give it the IP address, Ultra is .13. We're gonna send this to channel 4. Every media store channel has a video and an alpha channel. So you have up to 4 more still only frame buffers that you can run out of the sequencer. Of course, you can run animations off of USB cache that you load into the RAM cache. But this allows you to push stills directly from the expression sequencer. You can also treat it like a true CG. When you clear the frame buffer, it would send black and clear it out. The other way we can use this is we can leverage this to be a preview channel for us, showing up in our multiviewer and constantly updating with a thumbnail of the video. For now, we're going to set this up this way, and we now have that connected to Media Store 4. So if we go over to our preview and monitor, now what I can say is I'm going to make my master preview be that roslin output. And of course, we can name this, so we could call this Ultra Media Store 4. And over here, we now see Ultra Media Store Frame Buffer 4. When we see this, an image of a unique ID that XPression loads in, we don't even produce a thumbnail for it to be seen here. Now that we're here in the multiviewer, above me is the virtual panel, and below me is Media 4. Basically, the sequencer bar and what graphic is currently there. So if we highlight, you know, this lower third, we see it, we can confirm it, we can read it, double click on it, bang, in it comes. Take that offline, right? Offline it goes. And as we advance the next item, we're also seeing it bring that real-time render. That was a really neat look into how you can set up an XPression graphic system with your Carbonite Ultra. How to set it up as a device, how to send commands to it, how to configure it so it's ready to send commands back to the Ultra, and even how to set up roslin connectors for additional graphics channels or associating it to be a preview channel. As always, thank you for watching, and if you have any questions, comments, or requests, please send those to switchers@rossvideo.com, and we'll try to get on top of it as soon as we can. See you next time.